Welcome friends to the Ind AS knowledge series video number 7. Today we will be discussing one of the most sought after Ind AS standard and which might have been applied by almost every entity which has adopted Ind AS, Ind AS 12 income taxes. This standard is very critical for the preparation and presentation of financial statement for a simple reason. Every company has to recognize both the current as well as deferred tax to arrive at the profit or loss for the period. And the recognition, measurement, and the presentation and disclosure requirements of the tax expenses, both current tax as well as the deferred tax, is fully covered by this particular standard. Let's go into this standard. What I have planned to structure this entire standard is to show what is meant by tax expenses and what is the meaning of tax expenses we will see in detail, and how the current tax should be measured and recognized in the financial statement, how the deferred tax has to be recognized and accounted in the financial statement to arrive at the profit or loss for the particular period. What are all the practical application of this particular standard? There are cases where we require certain exceptions to be applied. There are cases where the company has only a deferred tax asset to be recognized. Certain concepts of prudence is implicitly or explicitly explained in this standard which we are supposed to apply. We will consider those items as part of the practical application. As we have started learning, we will also see what are all the significant differences between our Indian GAAP AS and Ind AS with respect to taxes on income or the income taxes. Naturally, we should also understand what are all the major disclosures to be made in accordance with this Ind AS 12. One caution which I have to give is that this standard requires an extensive disclosure with respect to both current taxes as well as deferred taxes, including a detailed reconciliation of the taxes applicable and what is provided in the books of accounts and what is an effective tax. I have taken certain examples and also some illustrative disclosure for the purposes of making you to understand this disclosure requirements in a much easier form. Let's move on into the standard and try to understand what we call as tax expenses. When we are talking about tax expenses, the major item which we have to consider is it is an aggregate of the amount which has to be included for the determination of profit or loss for the particular period. So that means what is the current tax for the period and what is the taxes which has been deferred and which may be taxable at a subsequent period or may be deductible at a subsequent period, because there is a difference between the book base and the tax base of the assets and liabilities, which we normally call it as a deferred tax. So both current tax computed in accordance with the requirements of the Income Tax Act and the deferred tax, which has to be recognized in accordance with the provisions of Ind AS 12, should be considered as the aggregate amount to be included in determining the profit or loss for the period. Let's go move on to understand what do you mean by current tax and how it is recognized. As you are aware, the current tax is nothing but the tax payable on the taxable profit for the period, or it may be recoverable in case if there is a loss in the current period. When I'm saying recoverable, It is not actually received from the department, but it is capable of being taken over in the subsequent period and adjusted. When we are saying it is capable of being carried forward and adjusted in the subsequent period, there is one confusion which comes to our mind, whether it refers to deferred tax or current tax. The standard says that when we are talking about the recognition of the current tax, the current tax expenditure should be recognized as an expenditure for the current period. That is, what is the tax outflow or the income tax payable on the taxable profit computed in accordance with the Income Tax Act should be considered as an expenditure in the period in which the profit is earned. Okay, current period, as per the computation of income tax, what is the tax payable, should be treated as an expenditure. It also says to recognize as an income in the period where the tax losses that can be carried back to recover the current tax of a previous period. Meaning what? If we have a loss in the previous period and that loss helps are determined in the current period, to that extent, there is a reversal of the tax provision already made. Normally, if you have seen in many cases, it says current tax adjustment relating to the previous period. For example, if there is a refund which has been received from the income tax department based on the order, but I have provided much higher tax in the previous year with respect to that particular period, because the losses of the previous periods has come into the books of accounts, and because of that there is a tax recovery or income which is arising. So to that extent, it will be credited as an income in the profit and loss account. So there could be tax expenditure for the current period, or because the tax losses of the previous period is being adjusted, or it is actually assessed in the current period, where the excess tax has been reversed in the current period, that will be treated as an income. So expenditure is also possible, income is also possible. Income is possible only in case of adjustment relating to the earlier years and not relating to the current period. Because if you talk about an income relating to current period tax losses, that is actually covered by deferred tax. So that is the reason why you have to be very careful. When it is relating to the previous period, when you are getting a refund or there is a reduction in the tax liability based on the assessment, that will be treated as a current tax income. Whereas if you are having the possibility of taking over the tax losses to the next year or subsequent period and adjust against the taxable income of that subsequent period, it gives rise to deferred tax asset or income arising out of deferred taxes. So this is relating to current tax. Now, how the current tax should be measured? Very simple principle. You have to identify what is the amount of tax expected to be paid to the taxation authorities. It makes a simple statement, measured at the amount expected to be paid to the taxation authorities. But if you are seeing this, nothing but what is the actual tax payable in accordance with the computation of total income for the entity is nothing but the amount payable to the taxation authorities. Sometimes it may be based on normal rates of tax. Sometimes it may be based on minimum alternate tax. Sometimes different items of income could be there, and those incomes are being taxed at different rates or special rates. So we have to consider all those aspects and come to the total amount payable to the taxation authorities. That should be considered as the amount to be accounted as the expenditure in the current period with a corresponding provision in the books of accounts. What is the tax rates which I have to apply? Very simple, because we are talking about what is the actual tax to be paid to the taxation authorities. What is the tax rates enacted or substantively enacted relating to the reporting period, or at the reporting date, what is the applicable tax rates that should be applied for computing the current taxes? Very simple process, nothing but the total income computed in accordance with the Income Tax Act, and what is the tax payable. Suppose if I'm saying the total income consists of some capital gains, and we may be going with an indexation benefit. After indexation, what is the capital gains and what is the special tax rate applicable, say 20% or whatever case may be. Then for that portion, we have to calculate at 20%. And for the other portion, if it is 30% is applicable, we will apply 30% tax and related surcharge as well as the cess. All put together is the total amount payable to the taxation authorities. And to that extent, that is the amount which we wanted to account for in respect of this particular current tax expenditure in the profit and loss account. Okay. Some companies used to have a cushion when they are making a provision for the taxation. For example, if they believe that when I make the provision exact to the pie and the assessing officer makes a different calculation of my tax expenditure, to that extent, it should get reflected in the current adjustment of the current year profit. So normally, some people used to have, if the actual tax comes to say 10 lakhs, they make a provision of 105% of 10 lakhs, so say 10.5 lakhs. So they make a provision. So even when they are making a provision, it's an estimate made by the management and accordingly nothing to worry about it. Where that 0.5 lakhs of additional provision made will have an impact is when we talk about the effective tax reconciliation, which has to be made and reported as part of the disclosure requirement, the 0.5 is not the actual tax paid. It's an excess provision based on a concept of prudence. So that time, we will remove this 0.5 lakhs additionally made provision. Otherwise, if a company wants to make an additional provision based on the past trends to avoid any shortfall in the provision for the current period, it is possible. Now, for current tax, I have made the point very, very simple by saying that the provision which has to be made will be with respect to actual tax payable according to the Income Tax Act. Very simple concept which we have learned. But for deferred tax, I prescribe a 10-step process. Again, don't ask me where is this 10 steps are given in the standard. If you wanted to decipher a mathematical formula, you normally use a step-by-step process. Even in the examination for chartered accountancy, you get marks for step-by-step process. So I have also understood that if a complicated process of applying a standard can be split into steps, it will be easy for remembrance. And accordingly, I felt that a 10-step process of accounting for deferred taxes will be of much helpful for both students as well as professionals for an easy understanding and without making an error in calculating and recognizing the deferred tax. Let's start with the first step. The first step says, determine the book base of the assets and liabilities. Normally, the book base is nothing but the carrying amount of the assets and liabilities. Why this book base is required? Let us move on to the second step and we will have an answer. It says, in the second step, compute what is the tax base of the same assets and liabilities. That is, what is the amount to be taxed or deducted in the future period in the tax computation of the entity with respect to that particular asset or a liability item, and compute that, and that is nothing but the tax base. Why this book base and tax base is essential for us to determine is because the difference between the book base and tax base is called temporary difference. So we have to find out, is there any difference between the book base and the tax base? If so, we have to compute what is the temporary difference between the book base and tax base. When we say the temporary differences, the temporary differences are arising in one particular period and capable of being reversed in the subsequent period or periods depending upon the tax laws. When the item can be taxed under the Income Tax Act, maybe in this immediate next year or maybe a subsequent year, or maybe a case where it will be allowed as an income or adjustable expenditure under the Income Tax Act, maybe in the immediate next year or in subsequent period. Let us take one example. If I'm talking about a case where I have fair valued my investments in accordance with the Ind AS 109, the fair value changes increases my carrying amount in the books. But for income tax purposes, the actual tax is payable only on disposal of the investments. Again, I will be able to get only the original cost of acquisition and not the revalued figure or the restated figure according to the fair valuation. And accordingly, the carrying amount, which is book base, say for example, the face value is 100, which I have paid to acquire that investment. Today, the fair value is 200. My carrying amount as per books is 200, book base is 200, but my tax base remaining to be 100, because when I compute my capital gains, I will take only the original cost of acquisition, maybe subject to indexation if it is permissible. So the tax base remaining to be 100, where the book base is 200. So when this difference, 200 minus 100, which is a temporary difference, will get reversed, if the entity disposes the investment in the immediate next year, it reverses in the next year. Suppose if the entity sells the investments over a period of time, maybe next year 25% and 50% in the second year and the balance in the third year, it reverses over a period of time. It is not only one single year. So if the temporary differences between the tax base and the book base is capable of getting reversed in the subsequent period or periods, to that extent, we consider them as a temporary difference. Suppose if a difference is not capable of getting reversed in the subsequent period or periods, but there is a difference in the computation. For example, a company made a payment of donation. Say, for example, we will consider that as a donation paid to a charitable organization as part of their CSR activity. Any expenditure paid for CSR, expenditure under Section 135 of the Companies Act, is not considered as a tax deductible expenditure. So in the books, I have charged that as an expenditure, but I am adding, or the tax base of the particular item is added in computing my taxable income of the particular year. So book base is zero, but tax base is, say for example, 500 lakhs is paid as the CSR spent, 500 lakhs will be the tax base of that particular item. But whether that 500 can be claimed as an expenditure in the subsequent period in tax computation, the answer is no. So in case, if the differences between the tax base and the book base are of such a nature that they are not going to be reversed in subsequent period, like the donation which we are talking about under Section 135 of the Companies Act, we have to simply ignore those differences. If you see AS 1222, taxes on income under IGAP, it uses the word permanent differences. Timing differences are recognized for deferred tax asset, but permanent differences are ignored. But Ind AS is not talking anything specific about permanent differences. It is only saying that you have to compute the temporary differences which are capable of getting reversed in the subsequent period or periods, on which you have to determine the deferred tax asset or deferred tax liability. So we are on the fourth step of ignoring the differences which are not capable of getting reversed. For the understanding of the audience, I should say that it is nothing but the permanent differences as being discussed in our existing AS 22. Now, what is the fifth step? I have ignored the differences which are not capable of getting reversed, but other differences are capable of getting reversed in the subsequent period or periods. But when they are getting reversed in the subsequent period, certain items will result in taxation in the subsequent period. Certain items will result in deduction from the tax computation in the subsequent period. Let us take one example. In the case where I am talking about fair valuation of investment, in the current period, the book base has increased. There is a temporary difference. But in the tax base remaining the same, so to that extent, that difference, which is a temporary difference, and it is capable of getting reversed in the year in which the investment is disposed. So in other words, in the year in which it is disposed, it is subjected to capital gains tax. So it is considered as a taxable temporary difference. If the item of difference will get taxed in the subsequent year or years, it is called a taxable temporary difference. We'll take another example. A company omitted to pay TDS on certain payments made to contractors. Section 194C requires the TDS to be deducted. And when we have not paid the TDS within the due date for filing the return of income, then Section 40A-1A says that 30% of the expenditure, related expenditure, whatever payment made to the contractor, subcontractors or contractors, should be disallowed for taxation purposes. Whether it is a permanent disallowance under the Income Tax Act? No. Because this item of disallowance can be claimed in the year in which the tax deducted at source has been remitted to the government. Say, for example, in the current year, 100 rupees has been, so 100 rupees is not the correct way. So I will use the word 100 lakhs has been not subjected to TDS. It is not deducted and remitted. So it is added to the income to the extent of 30%. So 100 lakhs means 30 lakhs is added to the income. Now, in the immediate next year, the TDS has been remitted. The 30 lakhs which has been disallowed in the previous year is available for tax deduction in the subsequent year. So to that extent, any item of differences which will result in subsequent tax exemption or tax allowance, then that is called deductible temporary differences. Okay. So if it is taxable in the subsequent period, that temporary difference is taxable temporary difference. When it is allowable as an expenditure in the subsequent period for tax purposes, it is called deductible temporary difference. So fifth step is understood. What the standard says, it's almost like AS 22, where it says that an entity should recognize a deferred tax liability for all taxable temporary differences. That means there is no specific exemption given for recognizing deferred tax liability. It's a liability or an expenditure. The concept of prudence very simply says that you are supposed to recognize all expected expenditure. So this is also provided for all the taxable temporary differences. Nothing but the deferred tax liability is created for all the taxable temporary differences. But step 7 is very important. When it comes to deferred tax asset, that is a deductible temporary differences, this standard, as in AS 22, asks you a first gated question. The entity should assess whether there is a probability of future taxable income against which this carry forward deductible tax difference can be adjusted. So if this temporary tax differences cannot be adjusted because there is no future tax profits is anticipated, then the entity says, the standard says, you should simply ignore recognizing the deferred tax asset. The word used is that, is it probable that there will be sufficient future taxable profits in order that the detectable temporary differences can be reversed, is what it's saying. So it's probable. When it uses the word probable, we have one important question: whether it is a significant difference between Indian GAAP and Ind AS. Because if you see AS 22 is talking about two concepts. Is it reasonable that there will be future taxable profit? It calls reasonable certainty of future taxable profits in respect of certain cases. But when it comes to unused tax losses and tax credits, for example, there is a carry forward of unabsorbed depreciation, or there is carry forward of business losses. So to that extent, AS 22 is asking us to check whether there is a virtual certainty of future taxable profits. What is reasonable certainty? It's a management estimate. Reasonably, it is possible that they will have a profitability. That's an estimate which they are making. But when we have wanted to create a deferred tax asset in respect of unabsorbed depreciation or carry forward losses, AS 22 says that there should be virtually certain tax profits in the future periods against which the reversal is possible. Otherwise, you should not create a deferred tax asset at all. So similarly, when we are comparing this, here there is no concept of virtual certainty which has been brought in. It simply says probability of future taxable income. So that means it's only talking a concept of reasonable certainty. Let's keep this as a question mark in our mind, and I will take it at the appropriate time from my parking slot for you to understand whether it is really a difference between Indian GAAP and Ind AS 12 with respect to virtual certainty. What it says that if it is probable, create the deferred tax asset. If it is not probable, ignore deferred tax asset for tax losses as well as the tax credits. What's the difference between tax losses and tax credits? So tax losses is I have computed the taxable income, which is actually a total loss. So that is the tax losses which are carried forward. What is the tax credits? I have depreciation which is carried forward to the subsequent period, which is a tax credit. I have 43B disallowances, which is allowable only on payment basis. I have disallowed certain items with respect to TDS not deducted, but it's allowable in the year in which TDS has been remitted. So those items of tax losses and tax credits has to be considered or recognized only if it is probable that the company will have future taxable income. So based on which, step 6 says you have to recognize deferred tax liability for all the taxable differences. I have identified what is the amount. Say, for example, it's A. And with respect to the detectable differences, I have identified 10 items, out of which 5 items will give me a probability and the balance 5 items is not probable. So I have ignored them and I computed what is the detectable differences. That comes to deferred tax asset B. A minus B will be the total amount of the tax to be recognized with respect to deferred tax under Ind AS 2. That's what we are saying. Compute and recognize the deferred tax asset and deferred tax liability in respect of the taxable differences and deductible differences. And one more question which normally comes to our mind is that in the balance sheet, I don't want it to show certain items of the deferred taxes on a gross basis. For example, deferred tax liability, I wanted to show that on the liability side, and deferred tax asset I wanted to show on the asset side. But instead, I wanted to show on a net basis, deferred tax liabilities net. So is it possible to offset? So you have to find out what is the possibility of you getting offset a deferred tax liability and deferred tax asset. The concept is very, very simple. If the deferred tax assets and deferred tax liabilities are arising on this based on the same tax laws and same tax jurisdiction, and the current tax and current tax asset and current tax liabilities can be netted off legally according to the particular income tax provision of that particular country or particular geography. Why I am using the word particular country? Even though I am operating in India, I may be having a branch operations in another foreign country where the tax laws will be different, tax jurisdiction will be different. And accordingly, I have to apply the tax laws and tax jurisdictions for each of the income, which is to be taxed in respect to that particular geographical area. And I have to find out if it is available in the current tax asset and current tax liability arising from the same jurisdiction can be knocked off or set off or offset as the correct word which should be used. So if offset is possible legally for current tax asset and current tax liability, this related deferred tax asset and deferred tax liability can also be offset. That is the ninth step gives us to do it. This up to this is a accounting treatment. So recognition, measurement is actually talked about this. Having recognized or having measured and having accounted that particular item in the financial statement, the other leg of the accounting standard normally asks you one question. That question is how it should be presented in the financial statement and how it should be disclosed in the financial statement. The steps 10 is nothing but what is the presentation required? What is the disclosure required? Apart from that, I have also added one more item. Give the reconciliation required as per Ind AS 12. What is the reconciliation? The reconciliation says, give an effective tax reconciliation. What is effective tax reconciliation? Assuming that there is no differences which are not capable of getting reversed in the subsequent period. What will happen? When I compute the taxable income, if there are 3-4 items which are going to be taxed at a subsequent period, I am going to create a deferred tax liability on those items. For other items, I am going to create the current tax liability. So at any point of time, if I add my current tax provision plus the deferred tax provision divided by the profit before tax, on the assumption that we do not have any item of differences which are not capable of getting reversed, or simple words for you to understand, even though standard is not using the word, if after ignoring all the permanent differences, or maybe I should use the word, if there is no permanent differences existing, it is only temporary differences. So in that case, the current tax plus the deferred tax provision divided by the profit before tax should be equal to what is the applicable tax rate for that profit before tax in the Income Tax Act. So, but there is a possibility that this may not be same. So if it is not same, for example, if I have to consider 30% should be the tax rate, plus assuming 10% is a surcharge, 33%, and 4% is my cess. So 33 into 4% is added, and then you have, say for example, 34% for our understanding, because instead of calculating exact number, assuming that it's a 34%. My current tax plus the deferred tax divided by profit before tax should be equivalent to 34%. If it comes, the effective tax is reconciled. If it is not, we have to explain why there is a difference by quantitative numbers and arrive at how it is reconciled with the effective tax rate. Okay, that is the important reconciliation which is required to be disclosed as part of the financial statement. Under the existing gap, still we do as part of the audit procedure or accounting procedure, whether the effective tax rate reasonably same with respect to the tax rate applicable. But there is no mandatory requirement to give an disclosure, give a disclosure in the financial statement. Here it is required to be disclosed as part of the financial statement. In the notes and accounts, it has to be disclosed. That's what we are saying, as a reconciliation should also be included as part of that. If you understood the 10 steps, computing the tax book base, computing the tax base, computing what is the difference between book base and tax base, and ignoring the differences which are not going to be reversed in the subsequent period, identifying what are all the temporary differences which will be taxable in the subsequent period, what are all the deductible temporary differences in the subsequent period, recognizing the deferred tax liability for all the taxable differences, and recognizing the deferred tax asset based on whether it's probable to have future tax profits for offsetting this deferred tax asset, recognizing that in the financial statement, whether it should be shown on a net basis, and making the elaborate or extensive disclosure along with the reconciliation of the effective tax rate. Simple 10-step process to understand. If you are thorough with these 10 steps, you will never make any error in making a calculation of deferred tax. Let's move on to understand each and every concept. So naturally, we have seen what is the difference between tax base and the book base or the carrying amount. Other than temporary differences, which originate in one period but does not reverse in the subsequent period, which we have seen just now, and those differences are outside the scope of Ind AS 12, we will ignore them. Temporary differences originate in one period, but probable that they will get reversed in one or more subsequent periods, then it may be taxable difference or it may be deductible difference. Taxable difference gives rise to deferred tax liability. Deductible difference gives rise to deferred tax asset. So I think up to this, we are very clear that the 10-step approach for calculating the deferred tax asset will help us to make our job easier. Okay. Let's take some examples for us to understand the concept of deductible differences as well as the taxable differences and the difference between the tax base and the book base. Trade receivable in the books is having a carrying amount of 575. So the book base is 575. As far as the Income Tax Act is concerned, whether it is subsequently deductible or taxable, there is no difference because the income has been already offered and that is forming part of the computation of total income. In that case, the tax base is equivalent to the carrying amount or the book base. So there is no temporary differences arises. Similarly, a loan receivable which has a carrying amount of 100, when I am recovering the loan, it doesn't have any tax consequences, only the interest is being treated as an income, and to that extent, the tax base and book base are same. There is no temporary differences. I have an investment which has acquired at 100 rupees, but presently I have fair valued at 150. So there is a difference of 50 between the book base and the tax base, because in books, the carrying amount is 150. But for the purposes of income tax computation, capital gains, it is remaining to be 100. So there is a difference between the tax base and book base. So tax base is 100 and book base is 150. There is a 50 rupees of temporary difference. And in this case, the tax is payable only on disposal of the investment. Because of that, it is considered as a taxable temporary difference, giving rise to deferred tax liability. I have preliminary expenses which has been written off in the books, but for tax purposes it is allowable under section 35 only over a period of 5 years. So what happens at the end of the period? In the books of accounts it is 100% charged off, but in tax I might have allowed only 100. So to that extent, in the books the carrying amount is zero, but in the tax, there is a tax base of 400, that is 500 minus 100, it's a 400 rupees is still carried forward for the next 4 assessment years. So the tax base becomes 400. When the book base is zero and the tax base is 400, it gives me the possibility of a deductible temporary difference subject to availability or probability of future taxable profits. If it is future taxable profits is probable, then I will recognize deferred tax asset on this. So we have fairly clear on how the tax base and book base are considered. As I am re-emphasizing the fact, you can consider the same logic in which you determine your tax base and book base as per AS 22. That will help you to do this without any issues. You will not make any error. Let me give you a small decision tree for you to understand the concept of deferred tax asset or deferred tax liability, as the case may be. If the carrying amount is in excess of the tax base, or it is higher than the tax base, in respect of asset, it will result in a taxable temporary difference. One of the example which we can take it is whatever we have seen with respect to the investment. My carrying amount as per books is 150, my tax base is only 100. So to that extent, it's an asset, investment is an asset, and it creates a taxable temporary difference of 50. And I have to create a deferred tax liability on that 50. If it is a liability, the position will be automatically reverse. So if the carrying amount of the liability is higher than the tax base, this is going to be allowed in the subsequent year as a deductible temporary difference. And to that extent, it gives me a deferred tax asset to be recognized. Now, suppose if the carrying amount or the book base is lower than the tax base, what would be the situation for an asset? Asset will give a situation of deferred tax asset, and liability will give a situation of deferred tax liability. Okay. So if you are able to understand how the carrying amount or the book base compared to the tax base with respect to an asset, with respect to a liability, then you can have a simple understanding. Whatever item you wanted to put it in this, you can find out a solution of this particular deferred tax liability or deferred tax asset, as the case may be, in respect of your asset or the liability. Let's move on. But one point which we have seen earlier with the example also is that the carrying amount is equivalent to tax base, then there will be no temporary difference. I need not explain this, but anyway, the concept is very simple. If there is no difference, then there is no temporary difference as well. So as simple as that. Okay. So what we wanted to check, whether this particular item will result in a taxable difference or a deductible temporary difference. Because after identifying the temporary differences, the next step says classify them into taxable differences and temporary differences, when we have seen that 10-step process. Let's see this. Interest revenue is received in arrears. Interest revenue is received in arrears. So what will happen in this scenario? I might have already offered this for taxation purposes on accrual basis. In the books also, it is recognized on accrual basis. And that has now come or recovered in the current year. Whatever is arrears has been recovered in the current year. It doesn't give any temporary difference. On the other hand, I have accrued the interest for book purposes. But as per the taxation requirement, it should be offered to tax only when it is collected. So in that case, then there is a difference, because it is already included as an income in the books and it is becoming taxable in the subsequent year when it is collected. So to that extent, it will become a taxable temporary difference. The facts of the same scenario, if it is already recognized as a revenue in books as well as it is offered for taxation purposes, only collection is done, arrears has been collected in the subsequent year, there is no temporary difference. But if it is offered in the books but being taxed only on receipt basis. When the arrears is collected, it becomes a taxable item, and to that extent it will give you a taxable temporary difference or deferred tax liability. I have made an investment in a foreign subsidiary, branches or associate, and there is a difference arises because of foreign exchange rate when I am converting that. So what happens? No problem. In this case also, only on disposal of the investment I will be taxed under the Income Tax Act. So the original cost of acquisition will remaining to be my tax base. But whereas in the books, I have, assuming that I have accounted at a higher amount because of foreign exchange rate has increased, to that extent the asset has also gone up. So it will result in a taxable temporary difference because the carrying amount will be higher in the books of accounts but lower in the tax base. So to that extent it will result in a taxable temporary difference for me. Now, inventory in the books of accounts has been written down to its net realizable value. Assuming that this write down is made on an ad hoc basis, the company could not demonstrate or give evidence how this write off has been done, the income tax officer is not allowing that as an item of expenditure for tax computation. What happens in the next year? My opening stock will be without adjustment for NRV. So that means it is allowable or detectable in the subsequent period, but I will be paying tax in the current period. So there is a tax base. The carrying amount of the asset in the books of account is lower, but as per the income tax or tax base, it's higher, results in a deferred tax asset to be recognized by me. I have recognized that as a detectable temporary difference, and deferred tax asset will be recognized depending upon the concept of prudence, whether it's probable to have future taxable profit. Similarly, assuming that the company is developing certain products, research and development expenditure which is incurred, and those in expenditure are capitalized in the books of accounts as per the intangible asset standard, but being expenditure on scientific research and development, whether these are qualified as an expenditure under Section 35 of the Income Tax Act, the company may have 100% of the tax expenditure to be allowed in the year of expenditure, or maybe even 200% depending upon whether it is an approved research product. In that case, the amount has been allowed for income tax purposes, but for book purposes it is capitalized. I will charge depreciation over a period of time on the development cost when the asset is ready, but that depreciation is not allowable for income tax purposes because it's already allowed for the income tax purposes. To that extent, the carrying amount is higher in respect of an asset, but in tax base it's zero. The development cost which has been capitalized has to be considered as a taxable temporary difference. There is a deferred tax liability arising out of it. Retirement benefit cost, which are allowable on payment basis. I created a provision for gratuity or compensated absence in the books of accounts and computed my taxable profits, my book profits. So the amount has been already taken as an allowable expenditure in the books, but for the purposes of income tax, it is allowable. That liability will be allowable only on payment basis. To that extent, the liability is higher than the carrying amount in the books of accounts. To that extent, it gives me a taxable temporary difference. I will create a deferred tax asset. Non-monetary assets that are revalued. What is the difference between this and the investment which has been revalued? Both are the same. Only difference is when I'm saying non-monetary assets like property, plant, equipment which are revalued, there is a subtle difference. It is also gives a temporary difference because the carrying value for the purposes of books for the purpose of claiming depreciation under Section 32 of the Income Tax Act remaining to be my original cost minus the accumulated depreciation as per the Income Tax Act. Nothing but the WDV of the block. But for book purposes, my book base has increased, but the tax base remaining to be the same. So to that extent, it gives a taxable temporary difference. But only thing is, where this item has to be recognized in the books of accounts. Because when the fair valuation of non-monetary assets are done, it is not taken to the profit and loss account. It is normally taken to the revaluation reserve, or as per the provisions of Ind AS 16, it is routed through the other comprehensive income. So accordingly, the deferred tax liability should also be created only in the place where the adjustment happens. If it is adjusted in the equity, then I take it into the equity. When it is taken to OCI, I will take it to OCI. So this is an important point which you have to take into consideration. That is what we are talking about, a balance sheet approach. We are trying to see what is the tax base of the assets and liabilities and what is the book base of the assets and liabilities. We are comparing both. If there is a difference, we are trying to identify the difference, whether it's a taxable or deductible. But the deferred tax has to be created and adjusted in the exact place where that increase or decrease in the asset as our liability has been recognized. If it is recognized in the profit and loss account, the related deferred tax will also be created in the profit and loss account. If it is recognized in OCI, it will be created in OCI. If it is created, adjusted in the equity, then the deferred tax will also be adjusted in equity. Let's take some example for you to understand on a go forward basis. So let us understand the initial recognition. This is what exactly I have spoken little earlier, but let us put it in some sort of flow chart. Whether this temporary difference arises due to a business combination. What happens in a business combination? I acquire a business. Ind AS 103 says that you have to take the assets and liabilities at their fair value on the date of taking control of the business. So when I am working out the fair value of the asset, let me assume that my property plan equipment are accounted on a higher value. But for tax purposes, assuming that it will be allowed only on the basis of WDV of the previous owner. We just assume, but normally it will not be the case, but we'll assume that it is going to be taxed only on that basis. So then there is a difference between book base and tax base. In book base, it is on fair valued basis, but in tax base, it's on the original cost or original WDV basis. In that case, it says that you have to recognize the related deferred tax asset or deferred tax liability. I'm talking about a case of an asset where the fair value is increasing and it results in a taxable temporary differences. Suppose if there is a liability which I have acquired and that liability is stated at a higher price, higher fair value because of fair value, but the amount allowable is not the increase, it is the original carrying value of the company which has been acquired. So to that extent, there will be a temporary difference again. That temporary difference will be a deductible temporary difference. So that's the way in which I have to adjust the related deferred tax asset. Suppose if I am saying no, it is not, the assets and liabilities are not acquired in a business combination. The next question which we ask according to this standard is that at the time of acquisition of the asset and liability, or when the transaction has been entered into, whether it affects the accounting profit or taxable profit. So sometimes it may be tax loss also. I'm just asking whether it affects the accounting profit or tax profit. If I say yes, then I have to consider recognizing the related deferred tax asset or deferred tax liability as the case may be. Suppose if I'm saying no, there is no such adjustment which is happening. It is not business combination. No adjustment is required. The transaction which I have accounted is same for book purposes as well as for income tax purposes. The transaction is not resulting in any taxable profit or taxable loss, then I will simply take that there is no temporary difference. Only point which we have to consider, assuming that we have determined that this is the total deferred tax liability and this is the total deferred tax asset, we have seen in the initial discussion that the deferred tax assets or liability may get reversed in a subsequent period or periods. So when we are saying subsequent period, it's 12 months from the end of the reporting period, short term. When we are talking about the reversal will happen in subsequent periods or periods, it may happen after 12 months also. So it may be a non-current scenario. So normally we have a tendency that if it is a long-term asset or long-term liability, it has to be discounted for time value of money. But this standard very clearly says deferred tax liability and deferred tax asset shall not be discounted for two reasons. The first reason, you do not know exactly what is the timing of reversal of the asset or liability. And accordingly, whether I have to discount for 5 years, 10 years or 20 years is not very clear to me. And to that extent, it is not possible to determine the discounting. So that is first reason. Second reason, the standard says the deferred tax liabilities and assets should always be considered as a non-current. So there is no concept of current and non-current. It says that you have to place it in non-current situation. So to that extent as well, so there is no requirement for making any discounting for deferred tax liability or deferred tax asset as the case may be. So it is on a undiscounted basis, I will recognize. So timing difference into what is the tax rate, that exactly it comes in, and I will not discount it based on the pattern in which I am estimating that recoverability or reversal will happen. So deferred tax, what is deferred tax? There is a temporary difference, which is a taxable difference, and the taxable difference is recognized outside the profit and loss account. Like OCI, I have recognized the changes in fair value of an investment in OCI. So it's outside P&L. Then in that case, it should be accounted in OCI. Suppose there is a fair valuation of certain assets, that assets are happening on the first time adoption of Ind AS. To that extent, any increase or decrease has to be adjusted in the opening retained earnings. When I am adjusting in the opening retained earnings, the related taxable difference is also to be adjusted only in the opening retained earnings, and the deferred tax should also be accounted in the opening retained earnings. You might have seen cases where companies have first time adopted Ind AS, or sometimes when you have adopted, see for example, when I am adopting Ind AS 116 for the current year, and some adjustment is happening in the opening retained earnings because of the transitional provision, then the related deferred tax should also be adjusted in the equity. Very simple. If it is outside the P&L, maybe equity, if the adjustment of the taxable difference happens in equity, it will be in OCI if the adjustment is happening in the other comprehensive income statement. Simple. So what happens if it is recognized in the P&L account? It is exactly what our AS 22 has talked about. Charge it as an expenditure, as a deferred tax liability, towards deferred tax liability in the P&L account. Suppose if I say, no, it is deductible difference. Then we are supposed to ask one more important question, whether probable of reversal against future taxable profit. In taxable differences, we are not asking the question, because it says very simply that you are supposed to recognize deferred tax liability for all the taxable differences, whereas for your deductible differences, you are supposed to ask one particular question, whether it is probable of reversal against a future taxable profit. If I say yes, then again the question comes with the same logic. whether it is recognized in the P&L account, consider creation of the deferred tax asset as an income. If it is outside the P&L, say for example in the opening retained earnings, adjust the deferred tax asset in the opening retained earnings. If it is accounted in OCI, then recognize that in the OCI. Okay. For example, to put it in simple terms for you to understand how it is happening. See, for example, there is a provision for gratuity, and the gratuity will be allowed only on payment basis. Some amount has been debited to P&L account, but the actual gains and losses of the gratuity has been accounted in OCI. What I am supposed to do is that, to that extent, it is a deductible difference debited to P&L as part of the employee cost. I will recognize the deferred tax asset in P&L when I am computing the profit after tax. When I have to compute profit before tax less current tax minus deferred tax, at that area I will consider this deferred tax asset. Whereas the actual gains and losses has been accounted as part of my other comprehensive income. So I have to recognize the related deferred tax also in other comprehensive income. That's a very simple. So where the difference is accounted, that's exactly where you should account for your related deferred tax asset or liability, as the case may be. Suppose if I'm saying it is a deductible difference, but it's not probable of future taxable profit, then I have to simply ignore that particular item. So it's a very simple concept of taxable differences. Only difference which we are finding in AS 22 and this, AS 22 says everything should be charged to P&L account only, whereas here we consider a case of adjustment in equity or OCI as the case may be. Even in AS 22, if there is a transitional provision which has been given, for example, first time when companies adopted Schedule 2, useful life of charging depreciation being charged based on useful life, that assets which has already completed their economic useful life are fully charged to the opening retained earnings. But there is an adjustment because the amount which has been charged to the opening retained earnings and eliminated from the book base, but the tax base, it's only the carrying amount of the WDV as per the Income Tax Act. There is no adjustment happening there. So to that extent, we have said there is a deferred tax asset arising out of it. The credit has been given to the retained earnings. The debit also has been given to the retained earnings. Suppose if there is a difference. Suppose if I'm debiting to retained earnings because the assets has been charged to the retained earnings, then the related deferred tax asset is credited to the retained earnings and debited to the deferred tax asset. So yeah, we have also done this, but only thing is normal prescription goes to a P&L, but here it says where it is originating, the exact place where you have to consider the related deferred tax asset or liability, as the case may be. It is a prescribed thing. The question is, what is the tax rate which I have to use for computing my deferred tax? It says tax rate enacted or substantively enacted applicable for the period in which the asset will be realized or the liability will be settled. So this additional item, the periods in which the asset will be realized or liability will be settled, is an additional aspect which we have added. In the current tax also, we have used tax rate enacted or substantively enacted as at the reporting date. So on the reporting date, what is applicable tax rate for computing your taxable income, we have applied there. Here also we are using tax rate enacted or substantively enacted, but we are not saying for the particular year, as at the reporting period, but applicable to the period in which the asset will be realized. For example, if I am saying that there is a 43B disallowance which has made in the current period, but it will be realized in the subsequent period. Current period I paid taxes at 30%, subsequent year I am eligible to get the concessional rate of 25%, I have opted for the 25%, then I should consider creating the deferred tax asset based on the 25% tax rate and not 30%, which is the current period tax. So future period at which the asset will be realized is what we have to consider. Similarly, when the liability will be settled. For example, if I have a higher book base for my property plan equipment, lower book base for income tax purposes, it gives a deferred tax liability. And that deferred tax liability should be accounted based on what is the rate at which I will settle this liability. Today, I'm taxed at 30%, but on a go forward basis, I'm going to get this allowed only at a different rate. That has to be considered. So not based on the current period tax and what is the period at which it will be realized. The asset is realized or the liability will be settled. And when I'm deciding this, we should consider what is the tax rate for that particular item based on the same tax law and jurisdiction I have to consider. So if there are different tax jurisdiction, I have to consider the related tax rates and related enacted tax rate of that particular jurisdiction for that particular item of asset or liability or temporary differences. So accordingly, different tax rates may be applicable for different items of temporary difference based on the tax laws and jurisdiction. For example, if I'm talking about a depreciation, a depreciable asset, then my timing difference will be taxed at normal rate. Where I have an investment which will be taxed under the head capital gains, I have a different tax rate. So I have to see what is the different tax rates applicable for different items of temporary differences. I have to apply that as the basis for calculation. Another question which normally comes to our mind, because AS2 has gave this extensive guidance. AS2 said, if the company is paying, sorry, not AS2, AS22 said, where the company is making the payment of tax on its book profit under section 115 JB, minimum alternate tax, because the taxable profits are lower than the book profits. So company has paid minimum alternate tax on the book profits. You know pretty well, the MAT rate is lower than the current tax rate. Assuming that MAT is 20%, for our easy calculation, I'm saying MAT is 20% and the current tax is 30%. How I have to create the deferred tax, or what is the tax rate I have to use for creating my deferred tax asset or deferred tax liability as of the reporting period? AS22 says, as part of the explanation in the standard itself, you should calculate on the normal rate applicable. There's an explicit guidance given in AS22. But in Ind AS 12, there is no explicit guidance relating to a situation where the company is making payment of taxes on book profit and has only MAT at this point of time. But if you see the first bullet, which I have said, tax rate enacted or substantially enacted applicable for the period in which the asset will be realized. So today I will be in a minimum alternate tax, but when it is going to be reversed, I will be in normal tax. And accordingly, I should use the normal rate of tax even under Ind AS 12, even though there is no explicit guidance given with respect to MAT. Similarly, what happens when I have some tax benefits because of tax holiday given? For example, ATIA for a power generation company. So what happens? With respect to the undertaking which generates the power, the profits might have been exempted in full, assuming that there are two more years for the company based on the tax holiday scheme. There could be some temporary differences which are arising in the current period, whereas my tax rate is zero because of the tax holiday. Whether I have to ignore the deferred tax liability or deferred tax asset. AS 22 says you have to consider those timing differences which are originating during the tax holiday period and will only reverse after the tax holiday period. Consider that and create only on them. Suppose if the temporary differences or timing differences are arising during the tax holiday period and getting reversed within the tax holiday period, ignore them. This is what the prescription given explicitly in AS 22. Whereas here, there is no such explicit prescription. But at the same time, again going by the first bullet in this slide, you have to consider the tax rate applicable for the period in which the asset or liability will be realized or settled. So if it is reversing within the tax holiday period, I am not going to have any tax rate zero. If it is going to be reversed subsequent to the tax holiday period, I will be having the tax rate of that particular period. Same logic. Only thing is, here explicitly it is not given as a separate interpretation or explanation, whereas in AS 22 you have that explanation in respect of MAT as well as temporary differences arising during a tax holiday period. But let's take some examples where the effect has to be given, whether in the P&L, whether in the opening retained earnings, whether in OCA. As we have said, if the effect of the temporary difference is given in P&L, you have to recognize the related deferred tax asset also in the P&L or liability also in the P&L. If the temporary differences has been accounted, the effect of the temporary differences has been accounted in the retained earnings, then the related deferred tax should also be accounted in the retained earnings. Suppose if the effect of the temporary differences is accounted in other comprehensive income, the related tax should also be, or deferred tax should also be accounted in other comprehensive income. This is what the basic principle we have seen. Let us take some example. Temporary difference due to depreciation. Depreciation is accounted in the profit and loss account. Effect of the temporary difference is given in the P&L. So the related deferred tax should also be accounted in P&L. There is a revaluation of property, plant, equipment, but if there is a revaluation, the revaluation impact is not credited to P&L, but it is recognized through other comprehensive income. Since the effect of the temporary differences is recognized in other comprehensive income, the related deferred tax should also be accounted in other comprehensive income. Let's take the next example. If there is an error in the prior periods, assuming that the error is 5 years ago, what the standard Ind AS 8, which gives the guidance for correcting a prior period error, says? It says go and adjust retrospectively in the period in which it is impacted. So if the period is a previous year, that's a comparative period, I will adjust. If it is before the comparative period, I am supposed to adjust only in the opening retained earnings. So the effect of the temporary difference is given in the opening retained earnings, and to that extent, the related deferred tax should also be accounted in the equity or opening retained earnings. Suppose if I am making an acquisition, Ind AS 103 says the assets and liabilities taken over should be recognized based on the fair value on the date on which you acquire the control. When I am taking that position, net assets taken over, fair value of net assets taken over minus the consideration will give rise to either goodwill or capital reserve under Ind AS 103. Assuming that the consideration which I have paid is higher than the net fair value of assets taken over, the difference is goodwill. But Ind AS 103 says goodwill is always a residual number. So that means I should plot all the assets minus all the liabilities, net assets taken over minus the consideration. If there is an identifiable asset, so to that extent, the asset, net assets taken over will go up and goodwill will come down. Let us take an example. The fair value of net assets taken over is 100 and I paid a consideration of 120, and 20 is a goodwill in normal scenario. But if I assume that some of the items are deductible, the fair values are deductible for tax purposes in the subsequent period, that gives me a deferred tax asset. So because the deferred tax asset is an identifiable asset, assuming that the deferred tax asset comes to 10, so net fair value of the assets taken over is 100, identifiable deferred tax impact is 10, total assets taken over is 110, my consideration is 120, the balance goodwill is only 10. In original scenario, it is 20. Because of deferred tax adjustment, it will be only 10. In simple terms, if a fair value adjustment arises because of an acquisition and recognized as per business combination, that gives rise to temporary differences. To that extent, the related deferred tax will be adjusted in the goodwill and not in equity, not in OCI, not in P&L. Okay? Because goodwill is a residual value. Mark to market with respect to hedge accounting. So what happens? Whenever there is a hedge accounting, the related position of mark to market is accounted in the other comprehensive income statement as per Ind AS 109. Because it is accounted under other comprehensive income, the related deferred tax will also be accounted in other comprehensive income. Now we are very, very clear. Where the effect of the temporary difference is given, that is the area where you have to account the related deferred tax. Okay, so that the net impact is accounted as a profit or loss or the adjustment in equity may be. Okay, we are clear on this. Let's move on. Okay, only one aspect which we have to consider. Suppose I have certain assets or liability which are giving rise to deferred tax asset or deferred tax liability, which is taxable or which are deductible at a subsequent point of time. The actual outflow will happen at a subsequent period of time. And to that extent, there is a possibility of a forex difference. What is payable as per the branch account and what is accounted in my books of accounts when I am converting, there will be a possibility of forex difference arises. That should also be accounted depending upon what is the nature of that particular item. If I'm saying it's a branch operations when I'm accounting all the items, and in that case, it normally happens as part of my P&L adjustment. If I'm talking about a consolidated financial statement where I have an independent foreign operation, then it goes into FCTR, which is accounted as part of the equity. The related deferred tax will also be accounted as part of the equity. Okay, this is also very clear. So forex impact should also be considered. Let's take an example of recognition of deferred tax asset. What is required? It says sufficient deferred tax liability available relating to the same tax authority and same entity in the same period. What does it mean? We are saying there should be a profitability arises, but here we are talking about sufficient deferred tax liability arises available. This is an example where there is an unabsorbed depreciation which is carried forward, which has to be recognized based on the concept of whether it's probable that sufficient future taxable profits will be available. But at the same time, if the company has recognized deferred tax liability relating to difference between carrying amount of PPE in the books vis-a-vis the WDD as per Income Tax Act, liability is recognized for the same asset, same item, deferred tax liability, but there is an asset which is ignored, which is incorrect. So it says if there is a sufficient deferred tax deferred tax liability available relating to the same authority for the same entity in the same period, you can recognize the related deferred tax asset up to the amount of deferred tax liability. You can consider that there is a automatic probability of reversal in the subsequent period. When the deferred tax liability reverses, the deferred tax asset will also get reversed. So to that extent, you can recognize. That's the reason why you might have seen in majority of the cases where the company is having only depreciation related deferred tax liability and unabsorbed depreciation, normally there will be a note. In view of the carry forward losses, the company has scaled down the deferred recognition of deferred tax asset to the extent of the deferred tax liability because the standard permits that. Suppose if it is not available, deferred tax liability is not available, whether sufficient taxable profit from the same tax authority will be available in the subsequent period for the deferred tax reversal. If I say yes, again I can recognize the deferred tax asset. In this case, I can give a simple example of 43B item. Future period, there will be a taxable income, so the DTA will get reversed, so I can recognize the deferred tax asset. Suppose I say no, whether any tax planning opportunity available to create taxable profits. Company makes some new taxable tax planning opportunity, some strategy which they are accounted for, which is permitted as per the Income Tax Act. Because of that, they expect that there will be a taxable profits. To that extent, if it is there, I can recognize deferred tax asset. If I say no such item, then I should not recognize any deferred tax asset. So either sufficient TTL or sufficient taxable profit or tax planning opportunity. If it is not there, I'm not supposed to recognize any deferred tax asset. Let me take one example for you to understand. B Limited is a newly incorporated entity. Its first financial period ends 31st March 2011, assuming as on the same date, there are following temporary differences which has been identified. Taxable temporary differences relating to accelerated depreciation 9,000. This is expected to reverse equally over the next 3 years. Deductible temporary difference relating to preliminary expenses 4,000, expected to reverse equally over 4 years. It is expected that B Limited will continue to make losses for next 5 years. Tax rate is 30%. Losses can be carried forward but not backwards. So loss can be carried forward but not backwards. That means if I don't have taxable profit, I will not be able to adjust the carry forward losses. That's what they are talking about. Discuss the treatment of deferred tax. Let's take our solution on this. So what we are saying, reversal of taxable temporary differences over 3 years period, 2014, because it's a 3 years period is what is given. So for the 3 years period, we have recognized. Reversal of the deductible differences will happen over 4 year period because the 4,000 is going to be on this. This is what given in the example. But what we are saying is that calculate the deferred tax to be recognized. With respect to the deferred tax liability, I have to recognize the entire for entire timing difference or temporary difference. So on 9,000, I will create at 30%. Whereas with respect to deferred tax asset, I can carry over only for 3 years up to 2004, because I am saying that it is not backwards but only on a forward basis. So on the fifth year also, when I am having losses, I will not be able to get that benefit. In that case, I am restricting to only the 3 years, and instead of calculating on 4,000 rupees, I am calculating only to that extent where it is allowable to be carried forward. So only on 3,000, I will recognize the deferred tax asset. Because the outlook given in this example is that it is a loss for 2015, because the reversal of the deductible temporary difference for the year ending 2015 is not going to happen, because it's going to be a loss according to the forecast which has been given by the entity. Okay. However, suppose if there is some tax planning opportunity available based on which the company will turn around in 2015, then I can recognize the entire thing. So to that extent, I can carry forward and adjust. I am seeing whether it is a taxable profit available. If it is available, I am adjusting it. If it is not available, if it is available, I can take the entire benefit. If it is not available, I am restricting to that extent the benefit is available. Okay, this makes us to understand that the concept is very simple, that all deferred tax liability should be created for all taxable differences, whereas a deferred tax asset has to be created only based on the actual adjustment which is possible, that sufficient future taxable profits are available. If it is not available, I cannot adjust. If there is a tax planning opportunity, I can change it. To that extent also, I will be able to get that benefit. If it is not there, it is not possible for me to recognize any deferred tax asset. That's what we have seen in that example. Let me take you through the next portion. Before that, this is an interesting point. Current period, I have decided that there is no future probability of taxable profit. But in the subsequent year, there could be a different scenario. Company might have turned around because of new business plans or a new demand for its products, or maybe the cost optimization which might have happened, or there are some tax planning opportunity which they have identified. So in those cases, whatever is unused tax credit, what is not recognized in the previous period, should also be evaluated whether in the next year the conditions are changing. If the conditions are changing, the entity is entitled to recognize the deferred tax asset on this. So there could be a possibility of recognizing of the deferred tax asset which is unused in the current period. Interestingly, the standard requires that entity should also disclose as part of the notes and accounts what are all the unused tax credits on which deferred tax asset or liability is not created. Actually, tax credits means it's only deferred tax asset, so it should be disclosed. And what is the expected period where that unused tax credits will lapse? In case, if I am talking about the present example, I will give an example of 1000 that is expected to lapse in 2015. So like that, I will give the example. Okay. So we have to review at every reporting period whether the condition continues to be the same or the temporary differences which are detectable are getting a better position because of the probability of reversal in the subsequent period. If so, I will recognize. That's exactly what we have explained. Interestingly, people used to argue that if I have unused tax losses and tax credits, since it uses the word, it's probable that future taxable profit will be available. So it's only probability, and according to the concept of virtual certainty, there should be a virtual certainty of future taxable profits is not required. Even if it is management assessment, probability of future taxable profits, you can recognize deferred tax asset on unused tax losses and tax credits. That's what some people take a view, but it's incorrect for two reasons. One, the existence of unused tax losses itself is a strong evidence that the future profitability may not be possible, or future taxable profits may not be available. That's a very clear evidence which may be understood when there is an existence of unused tax losses. Even if somebody is arguing, no, it's a tax losses accumulated over a period of time, but I have a different business plan. So to that extent, I'm entitled to recognize this because it's only talking about future taxable profit. In that case, also considered another paragraph of the standard. It says, only to that extent, please understand, only to that extent that the entity has sufficient taxable temporal differences or there are convincing other evidence that sufficient taxable profit will be available against that. So that means what? Whatever we are talking about convincing evidence under AS 22 or virtual certainty is also brought inside this particular standard also. Though not explicit, it also has the same principle when it comes to unused tax losses and tax credits. Okay. Accordingly, my view is there is no difference between virtual certainty. Because of that, you have not recognized any deferred tax asset on carry forward losses or unabsorbed depreciation. You are not having a different reason to have that recognized under Ind AS. That is my view, because the standard was very clear on this. We will take some quick questions on given scenario. PPE is carrying value 100 and a tax base is 60, tax rate is 20%. If the item was sold and a tax rate will apply at 30% in case of other income, compute the deferred tax liability. What it says is that I have a PPE, there is a temporary difference, there is no difference, no question about it. 100 minus 60, 40 is my temporary difference. I have the situation. But what it says that if I am selling the asset, the tax rate will be 20%. If I am using this asset for generation, then my tax rate will be 30%. This is what I have given an example. Normal tax rate and tax rate for capital gains, right? So here in this case, if entity is going to sell this, it has to create a deferred tax liability of 20% on 40 rupees. That is 8. Suppose it's going to use it, then it has to create at 30% on 40%, which is 40, which is 12. In simple terms, the expected pattern of recovery of the temporary difference determines the tax rate to be used. An important point for you to remember. What is the expected pattern of recovery? Is it by sale or it's by use? If it continues as PPE or it is available for sale or held for sale investment. Capital gains or your income under PPE. Profits and gains of PGBP. So you have to consider, and based on that you have to decide what is the tax. Let's take another example, an important concept. So in this case, an entity has invested in a joint venture and the joint venture has not declared dividend, but it has accumulated profits. As a joint venture partner, I am also entitled for 50% of the accumulated profits. So naturally, my value of investment goes up to the extent of the undistributed profits when I'm valuing my investment in that particular JV. So here, my original investment is 1000. My share of undistributed profits is 50. So but dividend has not been distributed. So in that case, whether I have to create any deferred tax asset or deferred tax liability. So what happens? My investment automatically goes up when I am accounting on equity basis. 1000 plus profit for the current period is 50, so 1050. But for the purposes of taxation, assuming that it will be taxed only in the year of disposal, so to that extent, I will be having a temporary difference. What it says is that the principle says, if there is any difference arising out of undistributed profits, who controls the dividend distribution policy? If the entity, that is the investor, has the control over the dividend distribution policy, then he has to recognize, he should not recognize anything. But if he is not able to control, he has to recognize the related deferred tax in the books of accounts at 15%. With the dividend distribution tax rate on 50, it has to be recognized as a liability. On the other hand, if I'm assuming that I have invested in a subsidiary or an associate where I could control the timing of the dividend, then no deferred tax asset should be recognized with respect to that. Even though I have used the word associate, normally in associate and joint venture, control may not be there, and accordingly, the timing of difference cannot be controlled by the investor. Only in subsidiary it is possible. So in subsidiary cases, you will not recognize any deferred tax. But in associate and JV, in normal scenario, you will not be able to control the timing of the dividend distribution. And to that extent, you have to consider the dividend distribution tax as one of the liability in your books. Clear? So let's take one more example. Deductible temporary difference of 50,000. No taxable differences against which it can offset. Because if you recollect the flowchart, we have said there is a deferred tax liability. To that extent of the deferred tax asset, it can be recognized. The deferred tax asset can be recognized. the entity is also not anticipating future profit, because the second condition says there should be sufficient taxable profits which should be available. That is also not available. But the third condition says if you are able to implement certain tax planning strategy, you can consider. So in this case, they say that I can implement a tax planning strategy by which the future profits will be 60,000. But for implementing the strategy, I have to incur a cost of 12,000. So net effect is 48,000 can be future profits based on this. And if it is certain that the tax planning strategy can be implemented, then up to 48,000. 50,000 is actually the amount of deductible temporary difference. But since I have a tax planning opportunity up to 48,000, I will recognize up to 48,000 at 30%, which comes to 14,400. What happens to the balance 2,000? That is an unused tax credit. So that will be carried forward in the notes as a disclosure. It will be evaluated in the next year whether the conditions are changing. If so, then again it will be recognized. If it is not recognized, even based on no condition has been changed, then it will be moved on to the next year. So it will be disclosed as an unused tax credit in the notes and accounts, recognized only when the conditions are changing. Up to that, it will not be recognized. This is with respect to tax planning strategy. Let's take another example. Because the parent here controls the subsidiary, it is not to be provided for. So that's what we have said now. If there is a parent is controlling the entire dividend distribution policy, to that extent you should not recognize any deferred tax liability or asset, as the case may be. Only if you do not have control of the timing of the dividend, then you will actually recognize. Here it has the control, to that extent it will not recognize anything. Employee stock option plan could be another possible challenge for us. In this example, we are talking about employee stock option plan of 50 lakhs each, which has been accounted in 19 and 2020. What is the impact of ESOP expenses? Why I have considered ESOP expenses are the actual expenses may get allowed for tax purposes only in the year of exercising that, and also based on the exercise price. Suppose if the exercise price comes to 40 lakhs, then only 10 lakhs is the, 50 plus 50 is 100 lakhs, which we have done. Exercise price is assuming that it's 40 lakhs. So 60 lakhs is the temporary difference, which will get charged to P&L as an employee cost. That's the reason why we are trying to find out whether it is possible. But having said that, you have to consider one aspect, that there are different case laws which says the employee stock option plan is never ever a tax deductible expenditure, and accordingly it is other than temporary differences and accordingly ignored. That is one school of thought. Another school of thought, very recently I come across, one of the company has said that they have precedents in their own case where the assessing officer has allowed it, and to that extent they will consider that as a temporary difference. So depending upon the scenario, you have to recognize the temporary difference, or you have to ignore the case, as the case may be. But this is based on what is the exercise price. That is also you have to consider. Otherwise, the temporary difference calculation itself will go for a different situation. Business combination, we have already discussed this. But I will take one example for you to understand, because how the residual value is working out. In this example, for example, A Limited acquired B Limited, and these are all the assets which has been taken over. The fair value is 570 and the carrying value is 595. So there is a temporary difference of 25. That means the company has paid a consideration higher than its carrying value, right? It has paid a consideration of 500. There is a liability of 100 is also taken over. It paid a consideration of 500. If I am just seeing the fair value, I will end up with having a goodwill of 20. But if I am considering the carrying amount, I will have a goodwill of only 5. Let us see whether this temporary difference of 25 between the carrying amount and fair value is allowable for tax purposes in the future year. Assuming that it is allowable for tax purposes, what happens is this 25 on which 30% is my tax rate, so 7.5%, 7.5 lakhs or whatever unit of measurement I have considered, that will be recognized as a deferred tax asset because I have a future adjustment, because the carrying amount can be adjusted for tax purposes at the same level, even though the fair value of consideration which I have, the fair value of the assets taken over is lower than that. So the residual portion comes as a goodwill. This is what we have said. You have to consider the impact of the goodwill only as a residual portion after considering all the identifiable asset, including the possibility of a deferred tax asset in a business combination. So this total amount is being settled by assuming a liability of 100 lakhs and then payment of consideration in cash 500. So this is a scenario where fair value of the assets taken over results in a goodwill, but the carrying amount is still available for tax purposes for an adjustment. Okay, in that case, it is considered at that level. That's an example for business combination. In goodwill scenario, what the standard says is you cannot recognize a deferred tax liability again on the initial recognition of goodwill. I recognized a goodwill of 25. Again, the goodwill has to be considered as a trap because my tax base is higher as an asset. My book base is higher, but the tax base is lower. Can I recognize a deferred tax liability on that? The standard prohibits doing it for a simple reason that if I'm doing this, it will result in grossing up my goodwill. So I will identify, say for example, on 500 rupees, 30% is the dividend, the deferred tax rate. So that will become 150. So I will make it as 650. Again, there is a timing difference of 150. Again, I have to calculate on 150. That will go on in a vicious circle. And to that extent, it says that it will result in grossing up of the goodwill. So it is should not be done. Goodwill should be only a residual value. And a recognition of deferred tax liability cannot increase the goodwill. Suppose the goodwill is subsequently returned down for impairment. Assuming that I have initially recognized 500 rupees. And subsequently it is returned down to 300 rupees as an impairment loss. That impairment loss is normally debited to my P&L account. I have to see what is the tax law position. If the impairment of a goodwill is allowable for my tax purposes, it becomes a temporary difference. So to that extent, what is charged in P&L is also considered. In that case, the 500 itself will become a temporary difference for me. Suppose if the tax laws says that goodwill will never be a tax deductible expenditure. So to that extent, any write down to impairment will also become other than temporary difference. So we will ignore it. Suppose if it is allowable tax purposes, initial recognition itself, I will consider the goodwill because it's allowable for tax purposes. And I will recognize the deferred tax asset when there is a fall in that, whenever there is an amortization which happens. But initial recognition, I will not recognize any separate deferred tax asset on goodwill or deferred tax liability on goodwill. Revaluation of asset, we have already discussed. Revaluation could happen because of revaluation of PPE or revaluation of investments to fair value, and that fair value is recognized in the profit and loss account. or I am fair valuing my investments, but that is recognized under OCI. When I put these three buckets, then you will know pretty well, because the difference is originating in OCI, then I will adjust in OCI. When it is accounted in P&L account, then I will adjust the deferred tax impact also in P&L account. So in revaluation of PPE, we said that it will go to OCI. So the related deferred tax will also be accounted in OCI. And fair value through fair valuation of investment through OCI will also go to OCI. To that extent, we'll also recognize the deferred tax on OCI there. Suppose if an entity, this is a common question which comes to our discussion as a practical question. Suppose if an entity first time adopts Ind AS and it fair values its land, a class of asset can be fair valued. And for all other assets, it's a retrospective applying Ind AS 16. We assume that. It wanted to do the fair valuation. To that extent, the fair valuation has happened. A credit goes to retained earnings, debit goes to the land. What we are saying, if there is a temporary differences arises and adjusted in the equity, the related deferred tax should also be accounted for. Land, when it is disposed of, is subjected to capital gains. Assuming that the capital gains tax is 20%, we will assess whether we have to create a deferred tax liability with respect to that increase, because it's going to be disposed of at a later point of time. Here there are two school of thought again. One school of thought says the land is the only land on which the factory building has been constructed. And if I am saying that this will be disposed of and creating a deferred tax liability, I am questioning the fundamental concept of going concern. And accordingly, it is not correct to create it. And as a going concern, it will never get reversed. So we should not recognize that. That is one school of thought. The second school of thought says, no, it anyway gives a temporary difference. And it's the standard says for all temporary differences which are taxable, deferred tax liability should be created. So you should create for this as well. Both seems to be logical, but practically, I believe that the first approach of not creating any deferred tax liability on fair valuation of land and taken as the deemed cost will be the better approach, because of the concept of going concern, and you do not know when actually it will get reversed. Only on disposal will never happen. So that will seems to be a better approach. Another complication comes in respect of the second scenario, where I recognize that because it's a long-term capital gain, indexation is also possible. So every year you have to see the indexation and reverse that impact also into the retained earnings, which I believe that it's too much for an entity to do it when it doesn't have the intention of disposing it at all. Okay. So my approach will be to consider with respect to land. So what is the tax rate to be adopted? Assuming that we are talking about PPE with respect to investments, etc., normal tax rate will not be applicable because the tax jurisdiction may be giving a special tax rate, 20% on capital gains. You should apply that tax rate and should not be applying the normal tax rate. When it comes to fair value through P&L also, it will be only on that basis, because investment may be considered as a fair value through P&L, but for capital gains, it will be offered only in the year of your disposal. Suppose if my business itself is to retain that as for regular business, then the fair value will be taxed on a normal rate. To that extent, you will use the normal rate. So you should see what is the pattern of recovery or what is the pattern of taxability on the particular item of temporary difference and use that particular rate, because that is the rate which you are going to recover, or that is the rate which you are going to pay at a later point of time. That will be the better way of handling this. Another question which comes to our mind is offsetting the deferred tax asset and deferred tax liability. So what it says is current tax asset and current tax liability can be netted off and shown as a single figure, provided it arises legally enforceable right to set off that recognized amounts. Then you can do it. Otherwise, it is not possible to do it. For example, I have 3 years tax provision and 2 years refund position. Can I adjust against that? It is not possible because of the income tax provision as of now, because the assessing officer has the right to net off the excess tax paid in 1 year against the tax demand of the other year. Whereas with respect to assessee, it is not available specifically with the assessee. So it is not possible. So if it is the same year, same tax year jurisdiction, the liability and the asset can be offset. Advance tax and TDS of the current year can be offset against my current tax provision and shown on in net basis. If it is relating to various period, the current tax asset will be shown as a separate item on the face of the P&L account. Current tax liability will be shown as a separate item on the face of the balance sheet. Sorry, not P&L. In both the cases, it will be on the balance sheet. If it is a deferred tax, what it says that, first of all, you should have the legal enforceability to adjust the current tax against the current tax liability. Then only you can adjust. Again, the concept says you should have the same tax loss, same tax jurisdiction. For example, I have a branch in Middle East and there is the tax law different and there is a deferred tax asset created in the branch, and whether that should be treated as the same tax law? No, it cannot be netted off. That's the reason why in consolidated financial statement, when you are consolidating the deferred tax asset and deferred tax liability of the parent and subsidiary, we normally show that on a gross basis in both the scenario. We don't net off. That's what I have said. In consolidation, you never net off this. Major disclosures is interesting. What it says in addition to that, what is the items which are directly adjusted in equity and what are all the unused deductible temporary differences, unused tax losses, unused tax credits you have to give, and what is the changes in tax rates, that is also you have to explain. What is the items which has been recognized in OCI we have to give, and if it is recognized with respect to investment in associates, subsidiaries, etc., that should be disclosed. And what is the component of deferred tax liabilities and deferred tax asset we have to explain. Let me just take an Excel file for you to understand the disclosure. One is, there is a lot of accounting estimates as well as management judgment involved with respect to current tax as well as deferred tax. So Ind AS 1 requires you to disclose that type of Ind AS 8 requires you to disclose that type of critical accounting judgment and estimates. And then you have, if there is any recent accounting pronouncement which has been made but you are not actually applied that, what could be the possible impact, you have to disclose. This is for 2019. There was some amendment which has not been given effect because it was disclosed here. And with respect to accounting policies, how you recognize current tax, how you recognize your deferred tax, and what do you mean by how your deferred tax asset has been recognized based on the probability which we have talked about. And unused tax credits are reviewed at each reporting period. Whatever deferred tax I have recognized is also reviewed at each period. If it is no longer probable, then whatever already recognized will be reversed. If it is probable and I have not recognized the unused tax credit, I will recognize in the current period. That is also mentioned here. What is the tax rate which I will be applying with respect to the deferred tax asset and deferred tax liability, that I have to explain. Where it is recognized outside the profit and loss account, it goes to the respective period. That is also, it is explained here. And what is the offset which has been done with the deferred tax asset and deferred tax liability, that is also explained here. So whatever we have shown as a disclosure, that is part of your accounting policy and significant estimate. And you are supposed to show the amount of current tax and deferred tax which has been accounted in the profit and loss account, that has been shown here. And it also requires a reconciliation of the effective tax. That's what we have done. The effective tax rate was 29.12. That how it is not being done, that explanation has been given. And what is the amount recognized in other comprehensive income has to be mentioned specifically. That is also explained. The movement in deferred tax asset, opening to what is recognized in P&L, what is recognized in OCI, what is the closing balance, what is the component of each of the items which constitute that deferred tax liability or asset as the case may be, should be explained. Interestingly, MAT credit entitlement according to Schedule 3 requirement should also be part of deferred tax. Okay, so that is the reason why in this company there is no MAT credit entitlement. For the purpose of our understanding, I put that also as part of it. If you have unused tax credit, we have to explain what is the gross amount and what could be the possible tax impact which you are accounting. And you should also consider for the previous year, 1 year comparative should be given. And what is the timing of the expected utilization or lapse? So that is also given here. So that is the way in which the disclosures are required to be given as per Ind AS 12. People normally make a comment that when you are explaining the concepts of recognition, measurement, accounting treatment, you are explaining with a lot of examples. But when it comes to disclosure, it seems that you are rushing little. But friends, I will tell you, if you have done your first 9 steps of deferred tax accounting, the 10th step is a child's play. You have to put the numbers into the respective bucket and you have to have an illustrative format. That's what I'm trying to give. So accordingly, I normally spend lesser time with respect to disclosure, but for the purpose of understanding, we are taking from the published accounts for your discussion. The last bit which I wanted to complete in this is that what is the difference between Ind AS versus AS? Ind AS 12 and AS 22, when we are comparing, Ind AS 12 talks about the balance sheet approach, whereas the AS 22 is based on income statement approach. We compare the items of income and expenditure considered in the books, considered in tax purposes. How the difference comes in is what we do in AS 22, whereas we are considering the tax base and the book base, which is a balance sheet approach under Ind AS 12. But both of them will give the same result of taxable difference or deductible difference. And it says that the deferred tax will be recognized maybe in P&L, maybe in OCI, maybe in equity, but AS 22 says everything will be in profit and loss account unless there is a transitional provision given in specific accounting standard. It requires very detailed disclosure requirement. That's what I have shown to you. Whereas with respect to AS 22, you have to only talk about the accounting policy and you have to give the major component. There is no need even to give a reconciliation of the or movement of the deferred taxes, not required to be given. Deferred tax asset or deferred tax liability may be required to be recognized on revaluation of assets, also maybe PPE or investments. And there is no specific guidance which is there, but normally that is also considered in AS 22 as well. Ind AS 12 specifically not talking about a concept of virtual certainty of future profits for recognizing your unused tax losses or unabsorbed depreciation or carry forward tax losses. But AS 22 specifically talks about supported by convincing evidence. But we have seen in our earlier discussion that even though it is not explicitly provided, the paragraphs talks about even virtual certainty or convincing evidence. It's not using the word virtual certainty. It's using the word convincing evidence based on which the company believes that it can be recovered at a later point of time. So to that extent, I don't think that there is a difference in real terms. And Ind AS 12, it gives specific guidance on MAT. Ind AS 12 is not giving specific guidance, whereas AS 22 talks about that. Similarly, Ind AS 12 is not giving specific guidance on tax holiday period, whereas it gives specific guidance in Indian GAAP. But as we have already discussed, even though specific guidance is not there, the accounting principle remaining the same, because Ind AS 12 is talking about what is the tax rate at which the asset will be realized in the subsequent period, or the tax which will be payable in the subsequent period, and accordingly the position will be remaining the same. So that, friends, is what I wanted to show to you with respect to this Ind AS 12 on income taxes. Hope you might be finding it useful for your studies as well as in practical situations, and keep giving your feedback, and whoever your friends who wanted to understand Ind AS more detailed. As I have committed, I'm working on almost all Ind AS standards to be captured as a video and then uploaded in my channel for the benefit of the students as well as for the professionals. But only thing which I have found out is that when you make a presentation in a CPE seminar, you are supposed to talk on macro level. When you are talking to the students as well as in practical terms, it should be a detailed and comprehensive presentation. And accordingly, even my earlier presentations has to undergo a lot of changes. I am studying what is provided in IFRS, what is given in our Ind AS educational material, what is given in the notified standard, whether that aspect has to be considered in my presentation or not. And accordingly, the presentation slides are increasing to cover on a comprehensive basis. Because of that, there is a time lag between my uploading the previous video and the new video. You have to bear with me, but it is my endeavor to ensure that even if the lockdown has been lifted, I will continue to record and upload all the Ind AS standards for the benefit of the professionals as well as for the students. And you, one request which I have is that some of the people are asking for my link for the existing videos. Maybe if you are following me, you can ask your friends and your colleagues who are also in the process of learning Ind AS, so that they can also be subscribers, and as soon as I upload the video, they will also understand this and they can also go to the previous videos which I have uploaded. So thank you very much. I think it's a very detailed and a very lengthy standard which has to be uploaded. So take your time and look into that and give your feedback as you are normally doing, which is always encouraging me. Thank you so much.